is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files. Short story from Briefcases, Aftermath. In this story, we get some of Murphy's perspective, and we get another encounter with the Fomor. Mm-hmm. They are creepy, and I don't like them. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm rolling thunder, pouring rain. I'm coming on like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take your prisoners once we're gonna land. Nobody's putting up a fight. Welcome to the show, everyone. I am Natasha.
I'm Rashawn.
So, Rashawn, how did you feel about this short story? The one that was probably the only one, I think, out of all of them that's placed after Changes, actually?
Like, right after, too. It made me think that if Karrin Murphy had her own series, I would read the fuck out of all of them. So, there's that.
Nice.
No, this was really good. This was a lot of fun in a weird, like, awful, terrifying way. Not a huge fan of these fish people.
Yeah.
Didn't love them.
They suck.
They really did suck. But I loved the way this story ends with the idea of when Karrin is talking to Will about how none of them alone can make up for the loss of Dresden, mm-hmm. but maybe together that they can kind of continue to hold back the tide of evil that's trying to come into Chicago. Mm-hmm. So that was really, really sweet. There were so many moments where she's literally holding back tears.
Yeah.
And every time that comes up, it was just like a punch in the stomach. Yeah, there was a lot here. There was a lot here, but I thought it was a really good story. And she's just so badass.
She's such a badass. It's so great.
You know, I don't know how anybody... I know you've told me, you know, that there is constant discussion in the groups about whether or not she's a good character, whether she's fun, people don't like her, you know, they hold things against her, and all this other kind of nonsense. I don't know how you read any of these stories, any of these books, and not come out with a huge appreciation for this character. I just don't understand it.
Agreed. I'll tell you how. Misogyny.
It's yeah, fine. That'll fucking do it, won't yep. it? You know, I mean, she's just so remarkable. She's so competent, which is something I don't know if people realize it or not, but, you know, if you didn't, listen to us while we tell you.
Oh, boy.
One of the things misogyny does is make women feel like they are incompetent and cannot handle any situation and are always in need of saving, right? Mm-hmm. So, there is a thought, especially like old school feminism, where it's like, if you just make the woman pretend or impersonate a man, that's feminism, that's equality, right? And that is not exactly how that shit works.
No.
What I love in this is this, there's this, what Karrin calls Martian, right?
Yeah.
And she's talking about how she had to learn, as a cop, how to communicate with men in a way that they understand. And it's like a series of grunts and basically inarticulate, you know, noises. Because men can't be fucking bothered to put a goddamn sentence together.
Yep.
To articulate what they're feeling and what they're thinking. So, like, on its surface, it feels like Karrin Murphy is a character that is of that school of thought, where it's just like, if you just pretend to be like a man and act like a man, you'll be fine. But she's so much more than that, mm-hmm. you know, because she's figured out this strategy to cope with her work surroundings and be able to work with the people she has to work with. But it's not all that she is.
Right.
You know, and she constantly shows us, and this story is such a good example because it happens with Ray at the beginning and then with the nothing later, mm-hmm. when she uses the very same move. Where she has learned to leverage the opponent's sides against them.
Right.
Right. And I feel like that is a bit of a metaphor for even just like leveraging the way men are unable to deal with their shit.
Mm.
You know. Again, and using that against them, because she has learned how to communicate with them on this level, you know. Mm-hmm. It was really, really good, and I didn't know how much I needed a Karrin Murphy POV. It turns out I really needed one.
Yeah, I really, part of what I enjoy so much about these stories when they are told from somebody else's perspective too is getting to see what people think of Harry, mm-hmm. and hearing her description of what it's like to watch Harry operate is
so
particularly
good.
Compelling to me because it sounds weird.
Yeah, there are a couple of moments where she's describing what it has been like for her to be on these adventures and journeys with Harry Dresden is as a mortal, right?
Right.
Just watching how powerful he is. There's a bit where she says, if people understood just how powerful he was, they would lose their fucking shit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you get to witness what he is capable of, and then you look at your own life, and you're like, well, I'm just not out here doing shit. You know?
Right.
And I love how throughout this whole story, she's imagining what he would say or do.
Yeah.
You know, if he were here, he would, you know, pinch his nose and look up to the sky, you know, or if, you know, he would make this dumb joke, or he would, you know what I mean? Like, throughout the whole story.
Can't belligerent with an authority figure.
Right? It all rang really true because she has been, you know, ride or die with him for so long. She does know him. Mm-hmm. And these little moments where she's doing that, I'm just like, oh my God, that's exactly what he would say right now.
Right, yeah.
That feels like 100% on point. He would totally, you know, have some remark about these fish people that was like kind of corny, but also kind of insulting all at the same time. And then just the reality of, this is a story that's taking place after he's gone.
Yeah.
This is our new world now. You know? And it is horrible.
It feels pretty fucking terrible, right? That's not, you know, just me.
No, even though, like, they are, like, technically this mission is a success, but we are still operating in a post-Harry Dresden world,
mm-hmm.
or post-Harry Dresden Chicago. And the idea that Marcone is the stopgap and has been, like, you know, keeping evil at bay. And now, you know, Karrin and maybe Will and whoever else, he makes a joke like, oh, we're going to be the Justice League. Like, is this what has to happen? Are these the people that are going to stand up while Harry's, like, not here anymore?
Mm.
And is this what Chicago looks like now? Because I think Guard at the end of the story mentions that these were Fomor, but this is like the second time we've seen them.
Yeah.
In recent bits, you know? So it's as if Chicago, not just Chicago, because it's happening around the world, they say.
Mm-hmm.
Like, all these things are in play now because of what happened to the Red Court.
Yeah.
And it really is a feeling of like, how are they going to do this without him? How? How are they going to fight all this without Harry Dresden?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't know, you guys. I mean, again, this mission was a success, but y'all.
It cost.
And I don't know how they do it. I don't know how these stories move forward. I just don't know.
Yeah, this is, I think particularly the whole thing with, like, maybe Marcone's the guy is really unnerving. Because he is just, I won't even say he's the antithesis of Harry, because that's not even really right. But I think were Harry here to see, he would be really upset to know that's whose hands Chicago is effectively in now, you know?
Yeah, I agree. I think Harry would be really, I don't want to say low-key insulted, but it would just chafe him, you know? Yeah. Like, this guy doesn't get to be both the villain and the organized crime and, you know, the bad guy, and also secretly the savior and the good guy, you know? Like, you gotta fucking pick a team. And Marcone has been able to exist in this kind of gray area in these stories so far, where it's that, what's that fucking expression, that whole, like, devil you know?
Oh, yeah. Right? The devil you know is better than the devil you don't.
Right? Yeah. So it's like, okay, well, we can have Marcone show up a couple different times and be on our side because he's better than the alternative. Mm-hmm. You know? But that only works when there's a Harry Dresden to, like, hold the line.
Right.
But if Harry is not here and now Marcone is the one that's in the position to hold the line and protect the city, you don't get to be both. Even though, you know, this is funny too, because this, in my opinion, this thing with Marcone that's been building over the course of the books is, again, just in my opinion, drawing on a lot of very old-fashioned ideas about organized crime. There was, I don't think it's really a thing anymore, you know, because the world is just a different place nowadays. But I can remember not only hearing, but as embarrassed as I am to admit it, actually repeating some really fucked up ways of thinking when it comes to organized crime. And one of those is a trope of how, air quotes, organized crime is better than, again, air quotes, regular crime, because they only deal with people who are also in the life, right? So there's no innocent bystanders, right? Do you remember, like, have you ever encountered that or felt like you've heard that before?
Not personally. I've always been, like, surrounded by people who decry organized crime.
Okay.
So, yeah, well, not
yeah,
really.
I guess so.
I mean, it's, you know, how I grew up.
There's this huge, like, sort of misapprehension that, like, organized crime is better than regular thug-on-thug crime because they only kill people who are also in the life, right? Right. You know, there's no, like, children that get killed by accident and blah, blah, blah. That's all bullshit because they kill whoever the fuck they want to kill. They are into drugs and prostitution and exploitation and extortion and all those terrible things. But there's this sort of, like, mythic
honor
thing. Honor, right? Mm-hmm. Like, we're somehow better than just common street criminals.
Right.
And Marcone is existing in that same place, right? Mm-hmm. Like, he gets to pretend to be a good guy because maybe he's not out there selling drugs to children.
Right.
You know, he's not out there shooting up neighborhoods. He's only shooting up competitors or employees that don't listen, you know? But that is bullshit. Because it's still crime and it's still murder and you're still killing people and you're still selling drugs and all that other nonsense. Mm-hmm. But he gets to, like, ride the fence, right?
Yep.
I could be a good guy, but I can also do my dirt. And Harry is like one of the few people that was in a position to look at Marcone in the face and be like, yeah, nah, mm-hmm. nope.
Like, you may fool them.
Right, but I know what you are.
Yeah.
And you're no different. And it's great that you helped us out in this case and in that case, but understand that if I can, I will absolutely take you down. Mm-hmm. And Marcone knows that's how Harry felt, because that's why he put all this energy and money into, you know, protecting himself against Harry. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And without Harry around, that just leaves him to be and do and whatever the fuck he wants to do.
Yeah, what did you think? Like, in the intro for the Marcone story, Butcher says, oh, by the way, remember how I told you that I did not like the narrator?
For that one-off.
It was Jim Butcher. Might be.
Girl, shut the front door, was it? Oh, shit.
A couple of people, left comments or DM'd me.
He is never going to come on the podcast because you was out here talking shit.
Listen, I don't even think that he's a bad narrator. It's not that. He just was not a good Marcone voice. You know what I mean?
Oh, my God. But that's hysterical.
I stand by it. I feel bad knowing that it was the author himself.
You were just like, I don't know where they got this guy from. Yeah,
it wasn't. I don't think they should. They should have gotten somebody else. That's all I'm saying.
That's the best thing I've ever heard.
Setting that aside.
You were really just like, I don't know what the fuck they were thinking. Like, why wouldn't they just...
Honestly, like, I want to play, a clip of it for you.
Oh, my God.
So that you can hear what I'm fucking talking about here. What's the name of it? Even Hand?
Yeah, that was his, yeah.
Hold on.
But I don't listen to the Marston one, so I can't really compare it to anything.
Yeah, I guess that's true. All right, won't do it. But he's got a very, it's a high, reedy sort of tenor voice. And for me, God. It just did not work.
Is he a high talker?
I wouldn't even say he's a high talker. He's just higher. I think of Marcone as having around this level voice. And he,
very measured.
Very, restrained, slow, mm-hmm. deliberate.
Yeah, devoid of emotion.
And
calculated.
He voiced Marcone like this, with extreme consonance and quite a great deal of over-emphasizing syllables.
Oh.
In a way that I was just like, what are you doing? And I kind of wonder if it wasn't like the director was like, dude, you need to enunciate more because this is, this is audio. This is the thing. I know you're not used to having it talk like that. And he just overdid it.
Oh, poor thing.
But anyway, did you read the intro where Jim Butcher says he thinks that he would have made a good feudal lord, that Marcone would have been a good ruler in that sense?
Yes.
What do you think of mm-hmm. that?
I think that checks out. Because of the way he runs his organization. And, to be fair, we've only really seen his high-level people. Mm-hmm. You know, we know Hendrix, we know Guard. We really don't know a lot about the lower-level people in his organization. However, it appears... There's a bit in this story, actually, where when Karrin shows up at Marcone's office and they're having lunch, but it's like a catered...
Oh, lunch. Right, yeah.
And you're just like, oh, shit, this is how he treats the little people. Mm-hmm.
I mean, there is a scene when they go to, remember when they go to the brothel that's masquerading as a gym?
Oh, my God, yeah.
And it turns out all of the sex workers get, medical and dental mm-hmm, and protection mm-hmm. and they get regular, pap smears and STD screenings and all of this stuff that I'm like... We don't get that. Right. What? You know, just, yeah, I mean, he's trying to take care of his people.
Yeah, there's when they talk about offering Karrin a job in this story, and they're like, you'd be wealthy and full benefits. Mm-hmm. Marcone understands something that a lot of our real life overlords don't understand.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Which is, if you give your people if you meet the needs, the basic needs of your people, you will get a better return than if you don't.
Agreed.
Right? Marcone understands that, you know, give your workers dental.
Right? Just, you know? Just make sure that they aren't going to, like, for example, how many stories that we have watched and read over the past however long are predicated on the fact that somebody was corrupted because a family member was ill and they needed to pay for medical treatment. Like, basic shit.
Basic.
This is where crime originates, really, is that people don't have what they need to live safely and healthily. Yep. And so they have to find a way to do it. And the only way that we're given, if we aren't provided for by our employer, is to do shady shit or die. Mm-hmm. And many of us choose to die.
Yeah, it's true.
Which, you know, and whatever. It's a choice, I guess. I probably will also.
But yeah, he understands that if you mitigate those concerns, people will be much more loyal, have less reason to seek outside help, mm-hmm. which is where the trouble always starts, when they start nosing around for opportunities to cover the shortfalls.
Right.
You know? I feel like, yeah, as a feudal lord, you know, his people, they might grumble, because that's just what you do as a worker, right? You grumble about the boss.
Hendrix seems to not agree with some of his management styles, like shooting guys really quickly after they just start to say half a word.
You know, but Hendrix is still showing up for work every day mm-hmm. and still doing his, you know, his job, as far as we can tell. So, yeah, I think that that description of Marcone really checks out. Like, this is of how he would run his serfdom.
Serfdom. Yeah. All right. I just wanted to address that because it sort of ties into this idea of who's left in charge. And, like, if things are as bad as it looks like they are with the Fomor coming in like this, maybe somebody like that isn't the worst choice. Right. You know? But
Karen's not impressed.
No, she ain't.
She's not impressed at all. When even at the end of the story, when she finds out that it has basically been Marcone defending the city, she's like, so what?
Yeah.
Doesn't make him any less of a fucking criminal and a scumbag. And that's Karen's particular sort of worldview. Mm-hmm. You know, she's got a very black and white sort of way of looking at the world, what's right and what's wrong. And whatever gray area that she has been, I think, I won't say created by, but shaped. Has been shaped and expanded by Dresden.
Mm.
What little gray area that she acknowledges, you know? Mm-hmm. She's still very much a, this is right, this is wrong, this is the law, and you're breaking the law.
Right.
Which we see when Guard is, like, offering her. You know, I think Marcone offers her a job when she's there in the building. And then at the end of the story, when Guard showed up, she offers her a job, if not working directly with Marcone, with the security company that they have. Mm-hmm. And Karrin is like, nope, you know, to all those things.
That's one of those that I'm like, I really think that it was the right thing to do, but I am dying of curiosity
to I see thought what she it was going to like. Take the Monaco security job. Oh, Monaco, I'm sorry. Monaco is like where I live. Like not far from where I live. I thought she was going to take that job. And I still feel like maybe she will take that job.
Do you? You had been thinking, like, she was going to be a Knight of the Cross.
Well, I don't know what to fucking think. Because that comes up in this story, too. I love how that comes up, by the way. When she is outside the doorway at the warehouse. And she is racked with fear and uncertainty,
mm-hmm.
and her brain says, you know what, we should go get that sword, because that shit was awesome and we were badass when we had it. And it feels like a reasonable thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah, let's run and go get that. And then she says, you know what, no, because that will end up being what I do every time.
And I'm just like, right? What's so wrong with that, Karrin?
And then she says the thing where she's like, you know what? It's not the sword, though. It's who has it, who wields it. And it was me. I'm the one who picked it up. This hand, the hand that I have, is the hand that picked that sword up. And I have two of those, BT Dub. I've got two of those hands. And I know it is probably not symbolic of any kind of greater thing, but more of a moment of just trying to steady yourself. But I really love the way she did it. By reminding herself of her own power.
Yeah. Agreed.
Like, because it could have been a moment of investing all the power in the sword, which would make sense because that's just pretty powerful. It's the sword of God, by the way, you know. So it would make 100% sense to me to put all of it on the sword itself, but she doesn't. She's like, no, some of that was me. Some of that I did.
Yeah.
You know. And if I did it then, I can, you know, I'm the same person. I have that same power within me. I can do it now. And even though it's kind of cheesy, I loved it.
I mean, that's the thing about, like, things that are sort of cliche but true is that they do feel cheesy sometimes. Mm-hmm. But you can't, like, that's just... This is what happens when you become a fucking hipster like me and are incapable of sincerity anymore.
Listen, when you're just dead inside, you know, y'all.
It's nobody's problem but mine. Sorry, everybody, for putting that on you. But I get it, and this is a real thing. And like believing in ourselves and realizing that we are the ones that have... Not to say that we don't... That there aren't, like, circumstances that can get in the way of things. But... It's very easy to give things outside of ourselves a lot of power.
Yes, yes. I think we are, as humans, more comfortable with ascribing power to things outside of us. Because I think, like, A, it's easier, you know? Yeah. Because if you acknowledge that the power rests within you, then you become responsible for how you use it. Whether you use it or you don't, you know? That ends up being on you.
Yeah.
But if you say it's the outside thing, then, oh, my hands are in the air, you know? I don't have any control over that. Yeah. So it's that struggle between, like, personal responsibility and faith. You know? Which is such a personal struggle for each person. And all of us come to it differently. We all, you know... come out of it differently, you know?
Yeah.
It's not a thing you can just say across the board for everyone. But for Karrin in this moment, the way she chooses to deal with it, I thought was... how can I say this? It felt really in line with what we know of her as a character already. You know, it didn't feel to me like we were making, like, some huge leap that I had to be like, oh, this don't sound like her.
Right.
Who is this? It felt very much like the woman that we've grown to know over these books.
Yeah, I really, for me, it's like one of those constant balancing acts because I take too much responsibility sometimes and because I'm a control freak and really want to believe that I have the ability to affect everything. And there is a point where you have to let go of things. And I'm not great at that. But with Karrin, it's such a particular situation because she's dealing with supernatural forces and she's just a regular old mortal vanilla human being.
Right.
So, yeah.
I love that throughout this whole story, Karrin never does this thing where she, at least as far as it felt like when I was reading it, she never says... Oh, but I'm special. I can handle this because of my experience with Harry. She just says, I remember when he told me about this thing. Oh, I remember when he mentioned this thing, you know? So it's not so much like she is... Like, here's the thing, and this is wild conjecture here. I feel like for Marcone, he feels like he might be special. and be in a special circumstance to defend the city of Chicago against these interlopers, right?
Interesting. What do you mean by special?
Because of his access to magic and having learned of it from Harry and from Guard, right? His access to money, power, he is in the best position to protect the city, but I feel like he thinks he's in that position because he's somehow special.
Interesting.
You know, which anyone who amasses that type of power, whether it's a CEO or it's fucking Marcone, they all think they're special, and that's how they got there, right?
Yeah.
Karrin, on the other hand, is not so much that she thinks that she's some sort of special, extraordinary human. She just says, I've learned this stuff along the way.
Okay.
And I can use what I've learned. But it's not that I think I am somehow, like, destined to be the great protector of Chicago, right? Like, it's not a destiny thing. It's not a universe saying, you are the only one who can help us all. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Whereas Marcone, it feels a little bit like there's some ego there that doesn't really, as far as I'm concerned, exist with Karrin, you know?
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay. I wonder, like, I'm not sure if I agree with you or not. I don't really have a theory on it formed. I think that if Marcone thinks of himself as special, the only real way that I quantify it, like, from his perspective, and I may be wrong about this, is competence again.
Right.
Because that is such a, I mean, that is what he says when he tries to hire her as well. I'm always seeking competent business partners, and I pay a premium for it.
Right.
And I could see that being particularly the thing that he's just like, I am far more competent than the average person, which, to be fair,
I'm in the best position, you know? I'm in the best position to do these things, yeah. To do this job.
I have the knowledge, I have the resources, I have access to people who know if I don't know. I mean, yeah, I don't know.
Now, I think that's a good point. I think the only thing I would say to that is that Marcone is about protecting his interests.
Mm-hmm.
And his interests happen to lie in Chicago. And so the threats to Chicago are threats to his interests.
Sure.
And that's what puts him in a position of feeling like he needs to, like, defend things, right? Mm-hmm. And Karrin, on the other hand, would be more like, I need to be in a position to defend the city because it is, air quotes, the right thing to do. And I don't think that that in itself is what makes her better than him, but I think that her drilling down to the idea that she needs to do this thing looks very different from when Marcone decides he needs to do the thing.
Mm.
But at the end of the day, I think the space between those two end results, I don't think there's very much space between them.
Yeah.
I think they're very close.
Yeah.
You know? So, the story starts on the Water Beetle with what looks like a crime scene, but is not officially a crime scene. And she is being told that she can't be here because she is about to be fired.
Yeah.
And is it Stallings?
I think Stallings is the one who comes and tells her to go away, yeah.
Right, right. And she's talking to this kid, Jarvis, Jarvis? Y'all.
Yeah, I know.
Are we naming our kids Jarvis? What are we doing? Is it a last name?
I don't know. She says that it's on his what do you call it? Name tag.
It better be a last name, because there is no excuse for that shit being a first name. Jarvis? Is he a butler?
That's what is I happening? Thought of, because that's the name of Tony's butler in Iron Man.
Oh my God, you're right.
Yeah, so that was like my immediate thought. I was just like, why is it? And I wasn't sure if that was like Jim Butcher doing a little thing, but this kid doesn't feel like a reference in any way. So I was like, I don't think so.
Fucking Jarvis. I can't tell you how upset I was by that. It's such a dumb thing, but I was really, like, I was put through the fucking ringer with that name. I couldn't get over it.
Ma'am, it's okay.
I was really distracted by it. But, this is so hard. But yeah, so she's on the Water Beetle, and there's a very long passage about where he could even be.
Yeah.
You know, his actual body. And, you know, they're going to bring a dive team out, and there's a lot of talk about how the lake, you know, is so cold and so deep, and bodies don't float, and, you know, it's just terrible.
Yeah.
And, we just finished Changes not that long ago. And yet, somehow, my brain was like, everything is fine. None of this terrible sweetie. Shit we just read happened. So, when I opened up this story, I was just like, oh, fuck, that's right.
Yeah.
And because it's taken so long before we get to the next book, because we're reading all these side stories.
Sorry about that.
I am going crazy. Because I don't know what the fuck is happening. Like, he can't be dead. So.
Why not?
Because it's only like book 12 out of like 145. I might be exaggerating.
Maybe. Nobody's certain at this point.
So having to read this story from the perspective of someone who is grieving his death, even though she's not really ready to admit that it is really what happened, like throughout the story, she's like pushing these thoughts away over and over and over again. It was really sad, you guys.
Yeah.
There's a moment where after Will comes to her and they have like the whole adventure, it's a bit of I feel like a little bit passes. I think they even get to the apartment building before Will finally is like, hey, by the way, where the fuck is Harry? And he looks at her face and knows immediately. Mm-hmm. And he's just like, no, 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 that can't be. No. And I was just reading like, oh my God, yeah, no, 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 it can't be. It was really, really sad and hard to read those moments of the story.
Yeah, I really, like, not just how he knows right away, but also the fact that, like, she is going to have this conversation again. Yep. And again.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Which is just so particularly mean.
Yep.
You know, yep, I just... Yep. Ooh, I didn't... I just...
Yeah.
And everybody's going to reassure her that he's probably not dead. It's probably mm-hmm. fine.
We're going to keep doing the same dance, you know? Right? The same sort of, he's dead now. Oh, wait, no, he's probably not. And then circle around and around and around.
Yeah.
And I just don't know if I have it in me to do this multiple times mm-hmm. as a reader. It was hard, and I just felt so, so sad for her.
Yeah, same.
So when Will shows up at her house, you know, after she's, you know, finally, like, gone home, because Solon is like, you have to fucking get the fuck out of here.
Solon tells her she looks like shit, and she's like, I'm dressed for a date. Excuse me.
She is dressed to the nines. How dare. How dare. And I had forgotten about that a little bit, too. That they were supposed to like me.
Oh, I can't believe you forgot that, because that's just, like, etched in my memory as one of the... Just that really, in particular, is a mean-spirited thing.
It is so awful. It's so awful. We have finally decided to, like, take a chance and just see what happens. Mm-hmm. Like, see where we are. And she shows up, and she's all cute and dolled up. And she shows up at the boat, and it's a fucking bloodbath, looks like, you know. It's just such a fucking kick in the stomach. Ugh. Horrible.
Yeah. I just really, like, what would you think? Would you believe that he was still alive if you were her? In her shoes?
You know what? I'm going to be 100% honest, you guys. I am not the type of person that is ready to accept terrible news when it shows up. Which is interesting because I spend my whole life expecting bad news to show up. But then somehow when it does, I'm always like, no. No. So when she's like, I haven't found a body, it don't count till I find a body, I was like, you know what? Yeah, that's fair. Like, until we find a body, he's still alive.
Yeah. Then, I mean, that's how I operate in books, especially, and right? TV. No body, not dead.
But she has this, then she kind of, like, has this moment of, like, well, I don't have a body, so I don't know. But then we spend a whole bunch of time talking about how bodies just disappear in fucking Lake Michigan, and you never see them again. So it kind
of
like...
I thought that was interesting. I didn't know that, like, the coldness of the water was that much of a factor.
Oh, yeah, me either, yeah. Yeah, it totally did when you're reading it. She's talking about how the, you know, the body doesn't expel the gases that would make it bob up to the top because of the temperature. I had no idea about that either. Which makes me think, you know, that's probably a good place to dump bodies.
Yeah, right?
Which she ends up saying, like, there's no telling how many bodies are down there. And there's a whole bit about how sonar doesn't even work because it's not just bodies down there. Mm-hmm. It's all kinds of garbage and shit down there. So, you know, it's like she has, you know, she's doing that thing that we all do where we're holding on to straws, you know. We're just grasping.
Yeah.
And I think that's what makes the rest of the story so much more painful whenever she imagines what he would say or what he would do. Mm-hmm. Because she's existing in this place where she's not quite ready to admit that he might really be gone.
Ugh, you know, I hate it so much.
Yeah, and I'm not a huge fan.
So, she leaves here, goes home, has a lot of trouble sleeping.
Yeah.
And then Will turns up at her front door. And he's like, Harry said, if he wasn't around or available to come to you. And I think, I'm thinking when he says that he knows what happened. It doesn't occur to me.
Yeah, I did too.
That he just, couldn't get him on the phone or whatever, you know?
Right. Yeah. Because he says he went to the house and the shit was still smoking.
Right? This is, like, the day after Chichen Itza.
Yep. Yeah, it feels like it's been months, and it hasn't been, like, hours.
So, yeah, he is talking to her about Georgia vanishing and how he was, like, on the phone with her and heard her scream. And she had been having nightmares, and we find out later that this was, like, you know, something that was upsetting her before these people ever came. And we know that that was because of the whole fallout of the Red Court being taken in one fucking swipe. So she's awake and drinking cocoa when they bust in there. But at this time, Will doesn't know anything about what's going on, and he brings Murphy to the house to check things out. And she does her cop thing, looking at what it was she was doing. Did she make instant cocoa or regular cocoa? Did she wear lipstick? Because there's lipstick on this cup.
Right.
And asking him to pick up scents because he's a wolfie. But he says that there wasn't anything good enough to really be able to follow.
Right.
Later on, he brings Marcy onto the scene, who is apparently, like, better at that than he is. And so she can track that scent. But for now, he's getting agitated.
Yeah, he's getting really... There's a lot in this story of, because it's from Murphy's POV, a lot of how she handles men.
Yes.
In general. You know, how she handled them in the department, how she handles Will, how she handles the nothing when that scene happens. And a lot of the story is how she manages male aggression when she is like a 5'2" little slip of a woman. Mm-hmm. And some of that is stuff we've seen before. We know that she, and it's mentioned in this story, you know, we know that she's, you know, practiced in martial arts and shooting, and she knows how to take care of herself. But we get these moments of her dealing with, like, even with Will, when he gets frustrated, and he doesn't mean to threaten her, but he takes a very threatening stance.
Right.
Because that's what men do, right? Men that are unaware, and I think this is actually said implicitly in the story, men don't consider how threatening they can be to us.
Correct.
To women, right? Because they have, generally speaking, a size advantage. Mm-hmm. So,
and strength, they can do, if not size.
Right? So they can, you know, switch up their whole body energy and suddenly be very threatening. Even if they don't mean to be actively threatening. Right? Yeah. And so she has this reaction when Will does it where she gets her stance, like, oh, we about to go? We gonna go now? Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Will backs down because that's not what his intention was in that moment. But that happens a couple of different times through the story, and I really appreciated that it was mentioned so clearly because that is absolutely a thing that women deal with. We go throughout our lives and we move through the world knowing that 50% of the population can best us as far as size and strength goes, mm-hmm. right?
Yep.
And we have to always be prepared for that. Now, she's prepared in a way that she's trained and she can, you know, get guys on the floor and, you know, pin their arm behind their back. But most of us can't and don't.
Yeah.
And I just really appreciated that it was mentioned here that we have to move through the world in this way. And that men are just like, you know, la 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 la.
Oh my
la.
God, yeah.
La, you know, just completely oblivious. I don't know. I don't think that men, TM, understand how
constantly aware of threats we are at all times.
Basically, mm-hmm. like, just how scary they can be,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're a woman and you're walking home late at night, you know, or not even fucking late at night, you're just fucking walking home at any time of the goddamn day, minding your business, yep. and suddenly a man appears and you are aware that, oh shit, this dude's here now,
mm-hmm.
even if he is not doing anything. You know,
yep.
you are aware that he is here now, and you have to switch your shit up.
Even a car pulling
to feel
by.
Safe.
You're like, how fast are they going? Are they going? Are they passing me, or are they slowing down? Like, yep.
Yeah, you know, like all of that shit that we have to constantly be aware of what they are doing and where they are in a way that they don't have to do for us, and how much space that takes up in our head.
You That's know? The main thing, is that I don't think dudes understand that that is such a big part of the way we, like, move through the world.
Oh, they have no idea.
And they then don't understand why we react in a hostile way to things that they don't intend to be hostile.
Yep.
And they think that we're overreacting. And it's like, we have to operate like you're a threat all the time.
Yep.
That's just, and if we don't, we get blamed for what happens to us. Yep.
That's exactly it. You know? So when guys are just like, oh, I just said smile. It's not a big deal. Well, how many other people before you said that? You know, how many other people in my history got violent when I didn't smile?
Yeah.
You know, or became hostile or aggressive when I didn't smile. You know, they just move in a way that doesn't have to consider us the way we have to consider them. Yep.
Yeah, and they consider us, no offense, dudes. I think that a lot of you are going to take this in a way that I mean to be, that you think I'm trying to be, like, either insulting or make you sound like more of a threat. But there's just not a better word that I can think of other than when men look at women, they are sizing up whether they're interested and how they're going to open that door. And I'm talking about, obviously, single dudes who are like,
you know, that's
they're out here looking for right now. And there is something that just feels predatory about that sort of interaction when you're on the receiving end of it, whether or not you are a, quote, predator.
Yep.
That feeling is still there for us because we know that you have, like, you have isolated us and selected us for your attention and are evaluating us as we talk to you based on our body language, the way we look at you, what we're wearing when we're talking to you, when you happen to like, we catch your eye for whatever reason. And so we have to react as if that's what it is, because we don't know anything else about you other than what we just got from this, like, 2 seconds.
When I first started, like, being out in the world on my own, right, like, late high school age, and then, like, immediately after high school, one of the best bits of advice I got from a friend at the time, and she gave me actually several good tips that have served me well throughout the years, but one of the first things she taught me was, if you're out and you're walking and men speak to you, if they're older, call them sir. And
that introduces a formality and a, like, distance.
A formality and a distance, right? Mm-hmm. And an acknowledgement that you are, like, much older than me. So you really shouldn't be, like... So what I mean by that is, she didn't say like, yes, sir, or no, sir.
Right.
But, like, you're walking home and somebody says, hey, girl, how you doing? Hey, sir, I'm good. How are you doing? You know, that kind of thing. She's also the one that taught me to spit, which I'm very fond of. That serves me very, very well. If you're walking past a group of guys, right, and people are getting all raunchy or whatever, and you just hock like a really thick, gross loogie, it will shut all that conversation right
down.
That's
amazing. Every time. I love it.
It always works, and I still do that. Like, if you just, a real nasty spit, they just leave you alone. They're so grossed out, they leave you alone. And by the time they get back to themselves, you're at the light and you're crossing the street.
There was a Instagram post from this amazing, like, bodybuilder, this woman... who does Olympic weightlifting. And some dude had commented, like, oh, you're so hot, I want you so bad, something like that. And she replied to him, every now and then I poop myself. I just fucking fell out laughing. There was a little, like, smile emoji after. But yeah, gross them out.
Yeah. But I don't know how we give this information to men in a way that they really digest and understand. Mm-hmm. That, you know, when you are walking down a street and you just say hey to a strange woman, that hey is going to hit her in a way that is probably not even what you may have intended. Mm-hmm. And that might feel unfair to you as a man, because you're like, well, I didn't mean it that way. But you don't get to be an individual in that moment.
Yeah, you're involving her, you so know. Guess what? Her you know, feelings are going to matter.
Yeah, you're just going to be like every other dude as far as she's concerned. And she's going to behave accordingly. And you don't get to feel a way about that.
An endless wave of unsolicited dick crashing on the shores of her day.
Basically.
That's what I saw in some post somewhere, and I was like, wow, there it is.
Yeah. Yeah. So, to bring it back to the story, when Karrin, oh my God, when her and Will go to this apartment complex, mm-hmm. and, you know, they're doing the just basic legwork of, like, asking people, did you hear anything? Were you up? You know, whatever. Mm-hmm. And it's not going well. And this is the sort of tedious cop work that Karrin is talking about. Like, this is like, it sucks. Nobody likes this part of the job, but you have to do it. And Will is getting more and more frustrated, you know, and more just like, this is a waste of time. Nothing's happening here. And then they meet the tenant, Maria, who appears to be this very kind of abused and harassed woman who is, you know, terribly afraid of this Ray guy who is just like, ugh.
Right.
He's just like everything ugh, that you hate,
the
right?
Worst.
Like, it's so terrible, you can't even believe he's a real person, right? It's just, like, it's too much. It's just, like, every fucking terrible stereotype. You know, he's fucking big, lumbering idiot, smells like cheap booze, you know, and...
And I love how she's like, he grunted at me in a way that meant fuck off and die. And then the next sentence that he says out loud after she asks a question is fuck off and die.
She says he said that shit in English, and I was like, oh my God. So, you know, Karrin deals with him because she's a badass, and she basically just has him on his knees looking like hella weak in front of everybody. And she's like, you know, you're done here.
I loved it.
It was an excellent moment.
I'm going to deal with him, and I'm not going to personally enjoy it at all. I swear. Yes, please.
Yeah, it's pretty good. And so then that's all done, and then Maria runs out and tells Murphy that she saw a guy come in a car, go into George's apartment building, and then come out. And the guy she's describing is Hendrix. Mm-hmm. Which Murphy recognizes, and that's what leads her to go confront Marcone at his office building.
Yep.
So her and Will show up there, and they get in to see Marcone.
They get hassled a little bit, and then she's just like, she's gonna be the one that causes this problem for him, which is always an effective argument.
Basically, like, do you want to be the reason? And Will loses his temper. And Marcone throws a knife at him.
Oh my God, I forgot. Yep.
And it's like, I'm going to need you to settle down or I will kill you next time you fucking threaten me. And then they tell her, no, Marcone tells guard to give them the information that they have. Mm-hmm. And that leads them to the email address, the Craigslist ad, that Murphy then uses to get the fish people involved. And they send Murphy to this fucking telephone, this payphone, to do this, like, this deal. But they have to disguise her because, you know, they figure people know who she is. And she's so, like, short that stands out. So they put her in, like, this goth outfit, like, these giant fucking monster boots and her hair, like, plastered to her head and dyed black and all this makeup. And she is just not here for this makeover.
I could not stop laughing. Like, I just had no idea this was where it was going. And I am dying for Harry to see her like this.
I am so mad that he doesn't see her in this getup. He would have gone to town. The jokes, they write themselves.
That would be it. That would be it.
Oh my God, it's so good. So she goes to the fucking phone booth, makes a call, and we hear from her, this person she's talking to is got like this weird way of speaking with like a lot of S's and very serpentine sounding.
Mm-hmm.
And basically she's going to pretend like she's got Will and Marcy, the other werewolf, ready to go and sell to these people, these fish people.
The Fomor. Just call them the Fomor. So the fish people. I can't take them seriously if you say the fish people.
But I feel like we need that description of it. And she says he looks like a frog. And mm-hmm. I was like, no, he sounds like a giant ass fish man. What are you talking about? He doesn't look like a frog.
I don't know if anybody's done an illustration of these guys, but if any of you, I mean, obviously this episode will be up by the time y'all hear it, but if any of you know of them, let me know, because maybe I can use them at some point.
These are giant-ass fish people. They have big hands that are like fucking fins, big wide mouths, long arms, watery eyes. These are fish people.
Okay.
Gills.
Yeah, frogs don't have gills. They're amphibians.
Mm-mm. They don't, exactly.
I was picturing their hands as being like webbed, like a frog's feet. Mm. You know what I mean? But
mm-hmm. I was thinking of them more as just like not being webbed, but just being kind of like I said, like fins. Like, no, never mind. I'm going to stop while I'm
okay.
She is just being really surly and insolent and rude, which we find out later that the Fish King did not care for. And, you know, does the deal and then follows them to the dock, to the warehouse where they're keeping their prisoners. Now, if I'm not mistaken, we don't know why they are grabbing these people. Just that they have something planned.
They're looking for people with magical talent. But for what? Yeah, we don't know that.
Yeah, right.
I think this guy, when he sees that they are werewolves, he says something like their blood has magical properties.
Mm-hmm.
But he doesn't get into any details about what that means.
And they're really upset because Murphy lies and says that she roofied them. And so now they're all like, well, I don't know about these drugs that might have it, you know. We might not be able to use them. We're not sure what that means. Which was a lie because she didn't roofie him. But they're very concerned about that.
Right.
Like the drugs might lessen their value. But so she follows them to the docks. And there's this great moment where she's kind of outside of where they are. And she's thinking about threshold magic again.
Mm-hmm.
Which comes up earlier when Will brings Marcy to her house because she doesn't really trust Marcy. And they have that whole moment where she's just like, who are you? And you just got back in town and all this shit went off. And
right.
But so she's talking about threshold magic again. And there's this great moment where she's like, well, do I push the door open? You know, like,
mm-hmm.
And then she does. And she's like, waiting for shit to like just explode, but nothing happens. She's like, oh, I guess we're okay.
I really enjoy how, like, irritated Will gets by the fact that she doesn't trust Marcy right away, but how practical Marcy is about it.
Yes.
Marcy's
yes.
just like, dude, it makes sense. I haven't been around. All of a sudden I turn up and then this starts to happen. She's right to be fucking, who the fuck is this bitch about it?
At the end of the story when Murphy says that she will, because she describes Marcy as being, like, mousy.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the story, she's like, yeah, I'm not going to make that mistake again. Right? Like, I'll never look at her like that. I'm like, you're goddamn right you won't.
Yeah, I don't know if it's on purpose, but the fact that her name is Marcy, which is so close to Mousy, also made me kind of giggle a little bit.
And, so, this is the Fomor, and they have, like, all the people that they have captured, and they're all in all these little cages, and they're under some type of spell, something that's making them docile.
Yeah.
You know, they're just kind of, like, zoned out. And Karrin notices Georgia, And she notices that she seems to somehow be fighting whatever the spell is. Like, it's not anything that she's doing, but Murphy says you can see in her eyes there's defiance, right? Mm-hmm. And then we get a confirmation a little bit later when the Fomar are actually saying about Georgia that she hasn't succumbed yet. She still hasn't, like, given in. Mm-hmm. And we don't know what it is that's enabling her to fight. I don't know if it's that she's part werewolf or that she's pregnant, but there's something going on with Georgia that's enabling her to have some type of resistance to this sort of spell. And then Murphy shoots that motherfucker in the head, and I was here for it. You guys, I was here for it. She blew his whole head off.
It is good
and stuff. I was like, yes, bitch, yes. Shoot them all in the fucking head. Let's go.
It's really a very different feeling to have her just pull a fucking gun out versus Harry being like for Zara or whatever.
Yes.
No offense, yes. Harry. Your shit's badass, yada, yada, yada. But I can't relate. I can't do that shit. I know mm-hmm. about a gun in my mortal right. world. I get that.
Yes.
That's some shit that I could do, ostensibly. Not as accurately.
In theory.
Siri.
This bitch, every time.
Every time.
Record,
I don't know what triggers it. I really don't. Because she picked me up and recorded me saying from the moment where I said, Harry, I get it, your shit is badass. What did I say before that got her, like, listening? I don't know. Whatever. Every time. It wouldn't be an unspoiled episode if I didn't stop at one point and go, Siri, shut up.
She's so fucking nosy. So, yeah, she shoots this motherfucker right in the head. And she's using a silencer. So, they don't know what happened. Right? They're like, what the fuck?
Yep.
And then she gets another one. But, and then I think the one she calls Nothing doesn't necessarily see her, but catches, like, the casings dropping
mm-hmm.
and follows the eye line up and then realizes, like, that there's something there. And that's when, like, all hell breaks loose.
Eek.
And it's her, Will, and Marcy.
Mm-hmm.
And this fight scene goes on for a while.
Yeah.
There's all kinds of dipping in and out of, like, the shelves and shelves and the, I don't know, whatever else they got going on in this weird. Because where they are is, like, a warehouse on the dock that has, like, freight containers mm-hmm. where they were loading these people into. So, they're all fighting. There's a point where I think one of the Fomar, like, gets rid of the lights, maybe? So now it's all dark?
Yeah, I think so.
And they're just fighting in the dark. And she's just shooting fucking everywhere. And I think Georgia is the one that manages to tell Murphy that they're using sonar. And that's what all the weird clicks and pops yeah. that she had been hearing was.
Such a neat idea. I really love that.
Right? Yeah. So then Murphy's like, oh, well, how about if I just let my gun go? Full blast. How about that?
Sucks to suck.
And then these things, they have because it was mentioned when they first get into the warehouse, she notices that there's, like, lumpy growths on the wall, mm-hmm. but she doesn't know what to make of them. And then it turns out these things, like, have, like, acid that they ooze that just, like, eats everything. Oh, so and they amazing. Also, like, spurt gas. Mm-hmm. So they have to, like, dodge those things, and they're fighting, like, the Nothing, I think, is one of the last ones that's standing. And Will and Marcy are out there getting it in, and it's just kind of like madness. You don't know what the fuck is happening.
Yeah.
And then eventually, finally, they're all done.
They're all done, indeed. I love, there's a part where one of them comes at Murphy with a, like, hook
mm-hmm.
that would have gutted her, but she has on some chainmail from Charity?
Yeah. She's got, like, two, like, a double-thickness Kevlar vest plus Charity's chainmail, so it doesn't get to her but it does, like, yank her across the floor.
She's very small.
That was pretty funny.
I do love, too, her pulling her trigger. Say what you like about the Belgians. They can make some fine weaponry. Listen. There was no flash, no thunder, just a soft wheezing sound and the click of the gun's action cycling. Thanks to the subsonic ammunition, the discharge itself actually made less noise than the round striking frog face's skull. which is just, that is really evocative. There were several wet, loud, cracking sounds. Ugh.
And frog face, the one... is the leader or whatever. Mm-hmm. And he's the one that was just like, did you get that bitch though? The one that was real rude to me? Mm-hmm. And they were like, no, I couldn't do it right then. He's like, all right, we'll come back and get her another time. Because her insolence is like, that can't stand. Yep.
Ugh, I hate it. So, and you know what? That's another like distinctly like, oh, we can't have her be disrespectful.
Yes.
Like, ugh. Get over yourself.
Yeah. They never do, though.
No, they never don't.
There's the big battle. There's like a lot of running around and hiding and shooting, and eventually they get them all down. Mm-hmm. And another like lesson from Harry is because Karrin is like, she brings everybody outside, and she's like, the sunrise will hopefully. Like, snap everybody out of whatever spell they were under.
Right.
Because she remembers that Harry had told her that, you know, the sunrise kind of acts as like a cleansing agent. Mm-hmm. And its spells oftentimes don't last more than a day.
Yeah.
So she has, like, brought everybody out so that hopefully they'll just kind of, like, wake up. And I was just like, oh, yeah. It's another Harry lesson.
I love that. Like, because it says, damn it, Harry, here I am doing your job at the end before she pulls everybody out. Yeah. And I remember Harry, like, she says something about how, is it because, like, the sun is good and, like, light is good? And he's like, no, it's not good or bad. It's just, like, bleach. You know? Right. He's like, you don't drink bleach because it's good. It's something that you use in measure to clean things, but too much of anything is no bueno.
Right.
And I thought that was kind of an interesting way of looking at it. Like, it's an agent that scours things in its way and is not inherently good. That's just what it does.
It's just what it does, yeah. Yeah, I like that a lot, too. Because we have this habit of wanting to ascribe good and evil to things, right? Mm-hmm. Because it helps us make sense of the world around us. Mm-hmm. But some things are neither. Some things just are.
Yep.
You know? And I like that there's room in these stories for that sort of thing. That, yeah, it would be very easy to be like, oh, the sunrise is cleansing and it's good and it's pure, mm-hmm. you know? And that's a way to go in a story. But that's not how these stories work.
Yeah.
The sunrise is just what it is.
It's like a force of physics.
You know? Despite what you might want to, you know, put onto it, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. Like, it is just what it is, because that's what it is. And I like that sort of thing.
Yeah, same. I just like any time that magic is seen as physics in these books. Like, that's how Harry approaches it a lot of the time. You can't get something without something being taken mm-hmm. by an equal and opposite reaction mm-hmm. type deal.
Right, right.
And I just think it's a really effective way of making things... have a cost to them that isn't necessarily like something ridiculous or sinister inherently. It's just, mm-hmm. well, you can't do a thing without another thing happening. I don't know what to tell you. Right. You know, it's very simple.
Right. It's like math.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I really like that she remembered that lesson from Harry. And that she had the wherewithal to think to use it in this case, you know, because, again, that is just, I think, a testament to her as a character that she has been having all these experiences with him throughout these books. But she hasn't been passive. She's been learning. Mm-hmm. She's been actively listening and actively learning.
Right.
And able to then use that knowledge, you know, to accomplish what she's trying to accomplish. Which, a lot of times when you have a series like this that spans as much as it does, one of the things that can happen to characters is that we forget to make it plain how the characters are learning and what they've learned and how they use it, you know? It's like with Buffy, for instance, right? One of my all-time favorite series. Buffy had difficulty, in my opinion, with showing growth with certain characters. Where you would see the characters, you know, face big bad after big bad and go through all these different things, but not be able to use, like, any of their past experience to inform what they do going forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know? And you would be watching and you'd be like, but what the fuck, dude? We just, like, 2 seasons ago. Mm-hmm, like, mm-hmm. why don't you know this?
Yeah.
You know? Why can't... and I like that it really, this whole story is showing us how much Karrin has learned.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah. Really, that's the whole point of all of this, is how much she has learned by being Harry's friend, being his accomplice, being his backup, you know, being you know, his friend. Mm-hmm. How she has learned so much from that and is able to use that information. And you don't always get that in these stories, you know?
Yeah, definitely understand what you mean.
You know, a lot of times only the hero gets to do that, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of times the side characters, the backup support characters, aren't given an opportunity. And to be fair, this is a side story, mm-hmm. you know? It's not taking place in the main books. So I like to think that this will carry over into the rest of the story, but I don't know that to be true.
Yeah, that's fair.
But I'd like to think that it does.
Yeah, I think that's a really, like, especially, like, talking about something like Buffy. It's one of those things that's really tough because that was the attempt to, like, create an ongoing series every single week for years. And that's something that I run into with Doctor Who as well. Just a really long-running show. And if people learn too much, I think they, like, the writers feel like they've put themselves in a corner. Mm-hmm. But you can still raise stakes and you can still make it interesting. You don't need for it to be, like, the same type of villain every time either.
Right.
And that's part of what's so interesting about this as well, is like there's a conversation between her and Will where she's talking about, like, well, they, you know, they won't want to upset so-and-so and blah, blah. And he's like, girl, the Red Court's gone.
Yeah.
We don't know what the deal is at all with anybody right now. We don't know how they'll react because none of the rules really apply the way that this they did.
Such a great moment.
Yeah. And they all just sort of stop and they're like, fuck, because we just operate a lot on status quo so much more than we mm-hmm. realize. And I think a lot of us, especially in the last 4 years, have started to see how much of the way things operated was just like tradition and, you know, basic morality.
This shit was only working because everybody agreed to the rules. Mm-hmm. It only took one person to show up and be like, fuck that shit.
Yep.
And our whole shit fucking fell apart.
Yep.
It fell apart. Because that is what a construct is, right? It only works when everybody believes in it.
Yep.
You know? And the minute everyone doesn't buy into it, it fucking crumbles.
Yep.
And that's where we are right now with our politics. Is we have, you know, people in charge and a fucking baby man of a president who just simply said, nope.
Nah.
Not interested. I mean, I know you guys, when you hear this next week or whatever, it'll be old news. But as of today and yesterday, all the news is all a flutter about how he got on tape, right? Mm-hmm. Did you hear about this? I know you didn't, right? Is on tape with a man who is famous for taping people. So I don't know what the fuck he was thinking, right?
Oh, this guy.
Like, do you know who Bob Woodward is? Mm-hmm. Do you know why he's famous?
Oh, yeah.
We all know why. He's famous for taping fucking presidents.
Yep.
Like, what the fuck are you thinking? But regardless, he admits on tape, on a recording, that he downplayed, you know, COVID and all that other nonsense. Mm-hmm. And everyone was like, oh, well, this is surely it. This is what we'll do him in.
And we say that every fucking 6 months, there's a thing that we really think is the nail in the coffin.
Right.
When are we going to learn?
And it did not do him in, as far as I can tell.
Nope.
It's been like 2 days, and I think he's still president. Like, all it takes is someone to be like, yeah, nah.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're all like, well, what do we do? He said, nah. What's our recourse? Nah wasn't in the book.
We need a fucking Harry Dresden in the Senate.
Girl, can we Fazari that whole bitch?
We need
bitch.
To fuego the fuck out of it.
So, oh my God, it's so depressing.
Look.
Y'all, sidebar real quick. How the fuck? What were y'all thinking? Maybe not y'all listening. But your cousins and uncles and aunties. Your meemaws and papas. What the fuck did we do? What did we do? Ciao. White people, y'all, I need y'all to have a meeting. Get together. Wherever y'all like congregate.
I tried that, but when I said meeting for white people only on Facebook, they banned me.
Did you see that fucking story out of the, I forget what college it was. They put up a meeting, like a Zoom meeting.
Oh, non-people of color students?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. To talk about race without the uncomfortableness of having to deal with black people while we're talking about race.
Well, and like, I read the thing and I got what they intended, which was,
I did
like,
too.
We don't want like people of color to have to educate what, but like, guys, yeah. You need to think of the optics of the way you name Listen. Things and put it out. Yeah. There.
People just don't think. They don't think. It was you. You shared that shattered glass fucking jewelry bullshit.
Oh my God.
I was so angry.
Guys.
I was so angry.
There was this couple that decided to make jewelry out of glass from shattered windows from the Charleston, was it?
Yeah, it was Charleston.
From the protests. And it was like, it was a white man and an Asian woman, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And like, they were donating the money to an organization, but it was an organization that I found
about that
questionable.
I found it questionable too.
And just named every piece of jewelry after a victim of police brutality. And it was just this really dehumanizing, tone deaf. Like,
where the Breonna?
Where
the George Floyd? Exactly.
Ugh,
yeah.
God.
And then the bitches behind it. You know, they videotaped the Starbucks incident and then I guess decided to roll that into a whole new cottage industry and career as like anti-racist activists.
Oh, that's right. That's who the organization mm-hmm. was they were donating the money to.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it was just, what a mess. Just people don't think about the optics of a thing. And I, like, your intentions may be good, but like, y'all, don't
think.
You dare.
I need you to think.
Mm-mm.
Like,
turning these people's names into a piece of jewelry.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what are you doing?
And glass jewelry at that.
Mm-hmm.
Just glass. What?
Yeah.
Ugh.
Anyway, Gross. We got so off topic. I'm sorry. But I was just talking about the status quo being gone because of the Red Court having been taken out. And how nobody really knows what the deal is right now. Like, nobody seems to know where the fuck these Fomor came from.
No, and this is the second incursion, mm-hmm. right? The second time they made a move into the city.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, all kinds of people have been disappearing.
Yeah.
You know?
Marcone's losing a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. And they're not all at this particular Fomor situation, right? Like, that's not the only place they disappeared to. Mm-hmm. That's where Georgia ended up in Andy, but we don't know for a fact that's where all Marcone's people, you know. Also, what does she call it? Involuntary termination? I guess people have just been,
Involuntary, like, dissemination, or something to imply that they've, like, detached themselves and moved on. Mm-hmm. In this very passive sort of way.
Right. And so we don't know, I don't think, exactly what's going on with all that either. But it sounds bad.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, so this whole, I really did love this story. But when we end, and I said this earlier, like at the beginning of the podcast, it ends with Murphy and Will sort of deciding that they're going to try to stand in mm-hmm. for Harry and protect the city as best they can with what they've learned from him over these years. And for me, reading this, the idea of contemplating a future without Harry Dresden in it was so sad.
Yeah.
And I just, like I said before, I really want to just get into the next book so we can hurry up and have him back alive, however that's going to happen. I'm not sure what they're going to make up, but I'm just willing to accept whatever. You know, because I don't want a whole bunch of stories without Harry Dresden.
That's fair.
So I need this next book by, like, chapter 2 or 3 to have him back. Like, and I'll just be willing to co-sign whatever it does. Like, I'm not even going to interrogate him. Like, oh, it's fine. That makes perfect sense, you know. And not even question it, because I just don't want a world without him in it.
Yep, I understand that. It's really, like, wow. When you come to the end of something like that, like, if you're in their shoes, you sort of get to this spot where it's like, well, I just really, when it comes down to it, I have two options. I don't keep fighting and know this shit's happening because I'm in this community now and I'll hear about it, but I just don't do anything. Mm-hmm. Or I do something. Those are your options.
That's it.
That's it. And they're not the people that just don't do anything.
No, they're going to do whatever they can. Yep. They're going to throw whatever they have at the wall and hope it sticks. And, I mean, this was a pretty hairy situation. Oh, my God. I hate when I do that.
It's so stupid.
But, you know, but this was, you know, like, this was touch and go for a couple of minutes there. You know, wasn't sure we were all going to get out. And it's not that I don't think that they can... I don't think they can protect the city the way it needs to be protected. I mean, I feel like they'll do their very best, but they're going to get ground down. They need Harry.
What about the White Council?
They just do. Girl, what about them? Mm. They got a whole bunch of other shit going on. I can't even imagine
exactly
what a mess
reliable.
That is. You know? So, I don't even want to think about them. I just want to think about how long do I have to wait before Harry Dresden is back alive. And hopefully it's not a whole lot. That's where I am. I need, like, chapter 2 or 3. He's back. Because otherwise, I don't know what we're doing.
All right. Well, you heard it here first, folks. Rashawn is going to quit next week if Harry is not in those first 3 chapters that we're covering. So, you know, everybody hold on to your butts. Yeah, the one criticism I have about the story is that it's quite long. I don't know
it
that it needs
very
to be
long.
As long as it is.
It does not need to be this long.
Yeah. It's interesting.
But because it was Karrin.
From Karrin's perspective and everything. I thought it was really she mentions how Harry, like, from the outside would look like he might be autistic.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that part.
Because he doesn't make eye contact with people, and his eyes are darting all over the place, and he seems to be, like, reacting to things that other people are not saying or doing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just this, like, there's a sort of disconnect from his behavior and social cues that other people are operating
right,
on.
Right,
And I thought that was a really interesting insight into his.
I love this way she says, like, that's like, she calls him, like, there's, like, you know, quirky, nerdy Harry. And then when he gets into his full power, it's a very different Harry. Mm-hmm. I did really appreciate that moment, too. I love this, the distinction between the two. Harry, when he is, like, not having to throw his power around, is just, like, you know, he's so tall. You know, he's so awkward and, like, lumbering in this weird kind of, like, you know, way that he moves through the world. But then when he's, like, on, mm-hmm. is a whole other fucking thing. And that's a very, not to make it, like, whatever, but that is, without the magic part, that is a thing that happens in real life, mm-hmm. right? Like, you know, you'll know a guy, you know, a man, and he'll be like, it's fine. You know, he's fine the way he is. It's fine. You enjoy his company. He's funny. It's fine. But then something will happen. And all of a sudden, you'll be like, oh, shit.
Right.
Check this motherfucker out. This is a whole other, like, I didn't even know you had all that in you. Whatever it is that causes that reaction, right? It could be, you know, the person reacting to a threat. It could be the person just being fully in themselves, doing something that comes, like, naturally to them and brings them joy and they feel confident in. Whatever it is, the energy changes. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden you're like, oh, this motherfucker get it. And that's what it felt like she was describing to me.
Yeah, I see that. I really enjoy the, like, he's gonna, walks around with this, like, exaggerated caution, too. Because yes. He's, like, oversized for the world mm-hmm. that he occupies. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. A lot of her little tidbits when she's thinking about him or talking about him are really good in that way. Because they're like, they're observations that she's making of him as another character, but they're also things that as readers we've seen ourselves. Mm-hmm. And we're just like, oh, yeah, that's right. That is what that is. Like, I hadn't put a word to it, really, but yes, he does move like that, you know? Yeah, I really enjoyed those.
All right, everybody. Well, we are going to wrap up, and our next recording is going to be about Ghost Story.
Hooray!
So, that's pretty exciting. I know that there are a couple of other microfictions that Butcher wrote that technically take place between Changes and Ghost Story, but they do contain some other spoilers, so I am not going to cover them at this time. We will check them out a little bit later. They're very short. Microfictions is like, you know, a page and a half. But they are, I think, not quite appropriate for where we're at right now in the story. I think that Rashawn doesn't have the information, and it wouldn't be the best way for her to get the information, in my opinion. So we will come back to those, I swear. And I think that's it. Everybody, you know, with me and Rashawn have restarted Song of Ice and Fire. So that's, you know, available to everybody on iTunes. You can check out Unspoiled Song of Ice and Fire for the first couple of episodes of that. I'm going to be working in the coming month on the website to make that more of a real, like, info-centric area for people to find the links to the Crowdcast, since I'm going to be doing another one for Battleground when that comes out. The links to the Unspookled episodes so that people can get a listen as to what that's like if they're thinking of becoming a patron for Halloween times. That kind of thing. So everybody, please bear with me because it's a lot of work and I don't have tons of like free time to do it. So it'll be slow, but I'm going to be working on it. And lastly, what on earth was that?
My Smurfs gummy bears.
Girl, you know I told you that I can hear it all, right? We've been over this. I think at this point in the show, I was doing my spiel.
I'm sorry, I was just getting my little area ready to close down.
It sounded like you were squeezing bubble wrap. It was crazy.
But they're Smurf gummy bears. I'm very excited about them. Steve found them for me.
Are they hard? Why do they make that sound?
They're in the plastic wrap still, so they're the hair.
Oh, that's why it sounded like bubble wrap.
Right, yeah.
Gotcha. So the other thing I was going to say was... I don't know what caused it, but I've gotten a sudden, like, big influx of messages from people, emails, messages on Facebook, which I don't know if I can even answer, but I'll try, Twitter, a bunch of them. And I want everybody to know that if you're, like, wondering if I'm going to write back, if you're asking me a direct question, I definitely will try to. I almost always do. If it's something that you're just like, hey, I just want you to know I love the show, I want y'all to know that I see them and I read all of them. I definitely will see it. I'm just not really going to be able to reply to everybody. I don't know what happened, but it just very suddenly, maybe it's returning to Song of Ice and Fire that did it.
Maybe.
But yeah, it just caused this like spike, and I just want everyone to be aware that we know you are out there and we love you also.
We do love you.
Yeah, you are very important to us because you're like the reason that we do this. But
you're the whole thing.
I don't want to just do like a form letter because I thought about writing like some copy paste thing, but I don't know. Is that like worse than not replying? I feel like it's worse. I don't know.
I feel like it's worse too.
But anyway, so I just want everybody to know I'm not ignoring you. It's just I physically do not have the time in the day to reply to everybody.
Right, right. And if you become a patron, then you don't have to wait for Natasha to reply to you because there's other people in the group that will engage you in conversation. You don't even have to worry about her.
That's true. You can take me right out of the equation.
I mean, what do you have to say anyway that you didn't already say on the podcast?
Honestly, I say nothing new in the groups. Nothing that you guys haven't already seen. I complain about being wet tubes because human beings are poorly constructed. I share food that I made, photos of that a lot, and cat photos. And that's pretty much, and like, you know, if you follow me on Facebook, I'm not on there as much anymore, but lots of angry political posts. So if you're into that.
Yep.
You can follow me on Facebook.
But otherwise, just join the group and talk to other people.
Yeah.
Because they're really way more interesting and exciting than we are.
Honestly, everybody else is what makes the group. I mean,
it's true.
We are the very minor part at this point. So it's pretty cool, actually, I'll like take a couple days where I've been busy doing stuff, and then I'll come in and I'll just see everything's churned right along. People are still posting, commenting. I haven't even need to be around, and it's still active.
And we're all very well behaved. You don't have to worry about any nonsense.
I was talking about this with Jamie today that somebody like said on another podcast, he doesn't gatekeep the Facebook group. You don't have to be a patron because it's not pay to play. And for a minute I got kind of sad and I was like, oh, mine's pay to play. And then I was no, good. I want people who are willing to like invest in the show as part of the conversation so we don't just get trolls coming in and out and being dickheads, you know?
Those other groups where they just let anybody
it's
in.
It's a mess.
That's just the fucking wild, wild west. Don't nobody want that.
So yeah, no. I sort of retracted my feelings on that.
Yeah. I only participate in gated communities at this point.
Agreed. Honestly, we can't be letting that riffraff in.
You really can't.
Lowering the value of the whole area. all right, guys, thank you all so much for listening. We love you so much, and we will see you next week with the start of Ghost Story.
Yay!
Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Unspoiled Network Podcast.